keeps me going, man.
I was
going
to say.
Well, good morning, everybody. What we're going to do is begin the public forum as part of our meeting today. And again, for those who may be watching on TV or anybody in the audience new, this is an opportunity for people to bring issues forward for the board that are of concern. We have had our staff available before the meeting, hopefully can address some of the issues. And if the issue isn't something we can address, we'll hopefully be able to refer it to staff to get you to the right people that maybe can address your concerns. But this is an opportunity to hear from you about your concerns and issues. I will point out that we do have a public hearing on an ordinance later. So if I think we've got people signed up for the public forum who just want to speak on other issues other than that that ordinance, we will have an ordinance a public hearing on that ordinance later in the meeting. And so if you want to speak on that, if you want to do that during this public forum, that's fine. But I would also encourage you to come and make your comments when we have the public hearing on that particular ordinance. We have a sign up half hour before the meeting starts, shut it off at 9 o'clock. We have, I believe, five people who are looking to testify before us this morning. I'm going to ask that you keep your comments brief, 3 minutes if possible. And I understand there's a group that would like to come up as together, three of you, and I'm going to call you all up right now. Willie Moore, Lori Wall, and Minam Hecht, is that what it is? No, is it?
Miriam,
okay.
I didn't write my own.
Oh, that's an I, I got it. Miriam, okay. Good morning, everybody.
Good morning, members of the TriMet Board of Directors. I am Lori Wall, one of the authors of the letter to Mr. McFarland regarding our request for the Terry Moore Memorial. Two of the others will speak today as well. They are Willie Moore, Terry's husband, and Miriam Hecht. Also in attendance are a number of supporters of our proposal who I will ask to stand now.
Good morning.
We are requesting that the pedestrian bridge over Sunset Highway at the Sunset Transit Center be named for Terry S. Hofferber Moore, who was instrumental in getting it built and built properly when she was the Metro Councilor from 1992 to 1995. Terry passed away in June 2014. She was very proud of helping to provide a pathway for bus and light rail passengers and for pedestrians to access shops and residences on the south side of Sunset Highway. She said during a Metro Councilor oral history interview, "And I'm always proud of my little pedestrian bridge across Sunset Highway. If that's my legacy, I'm happy." Prior to Terry's success with the Sunset Transit Center, she persuaded the TriMet board to buy all future MAX light rail cars and TriMet buses with low floor, no step style access. This was not only to comply with the Americans with Disabilities Act, but also to allow for better access for all users, including people with strollers and the elderly. Additionally, this low floor access significantly improved transit schedule reliability. Portland was a national model for transit design because of the low floor light rail cars and buses. Terry has a long list of civic leadership successes, too many to name here. Last month, she was a co-recipient of the Haynes Citizen Involvement Award, honoring outstanding leadership and engaging community members in civic affairs in Washington County. I was fortunate to work with Terry at the City of Portland Planning Bureau for many years. During that time and in later years, I was continually amazed by her skill, fortitude, and the power of her example of doing good for our community. Undoubtedly, the over 80 people who joined in with us on the letter before you today and many others are better people because they knew Terry. We are asking that you take her message farther. We're asking you to spread Terry's strong grasp of the importance of civic contribution by naming the bridge for her. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. I'm Miriam Hecht, ex-city planner. Terry might be the last person to have this attention paid to her, but that's just the kind of person we should all be honoring. She gave the term politician a good rep. She felt community activism was the way to get things done. She made sure others became community activists and she made civil service something others would be proud of. I met Terry when we were civil servants, and that's an odd term, I think, when she was secretary to the Planning Commission and I was a young city planner in this very spot before this building was built, and it was McElroy's Ballroom, and it had no elevator, and Terry was carried up and down the stairs every day. It was a long time ago. Terry went on to become a metro councilor and member of the Tualatin Hills Parks and Recreation Board and Audubon Society boards. She is the reason that Olson Road in Washington County works without being a freeway and beautifies and promotes the Garden Home neighborhood. She is the reason many enjoy the nature of Fano Creek in Southwest Portland and Garden Home. She is the reason we can all cross Highway 26 to get to light rail, the parking structure, Providence, St. Vincent's, and the Cedar Mill shopping area. She is the reason people with mobility issues can easily ride rapid transit in the Portland region and all over the country. She did these things masterfully with incredible foresight, determination, organization, and perseverance. And importantly, she left us with a legacy of others to continue this work. Several of our local politicians and activists are in it because of Terry. I think you'd be surprised at how many people, family, commissioners, council people, directors, friends, and community stewards would say, "Terry made me do it." And we all benefit from that. She handpicked, she encouraged, she mentored, and supported. Some of these include Catherine Harrington, a Metro Councilor, Dick Shelton, Scouting, and Gary Malinowski, Washington County Commissioners, John Griffith, Deanna Crispin Mueller, Joe Blauer of the THRPD Board, and Stan Hausman of Washington County CPO. Terry's work ethic was infectious. Her wanting to make a difference and actually doing it were her raison d'etre, and she spoke French better than I can. She's worthy of something lasting here. I understand the TriMet Board doesn't have an exact policy at my time, policy or protocol for naming structures. We think this is a good place to start, honoring an individual who didn't ask for it, didn't pay for it, is responsible for it, and by recognition may have others ask, who is this and why is her name here? And when they find out, they will learn that individuals really can make a lasting positive difference for the community with ideas and hard work. Her projects were about access, reasonableness, and nature. Many were located in Washington County, where she lived, and the results of her work are appreciated all over the region and the country. That is why this bridge is appropriate. And I believe she has all the records to show about her projects. It would be nice to acknowledge and appreciate the woman who's responsible for improving this access. Some walk their talk. Terry wheeled her spiel.
Mr. Warner, TriMet Board, and Mr. McFarland, thank you very much for the opportunity to speak to you this morning. As a bit of full disclosure, I am a previous TriMet employee and I'm now a retired TriMet employee. I'm very passionate about my wife, and I mean that in all aspects. I viewed circumstances because of my previous career in the military as taking orders from the top down, and I engaged my wife. She introduced me to the concept of from the bottom up, influencing how policy gets built. 1984 was really seminal in my and my wife's experience in terms of a very crucial point in which TriMet was making a decision on how to make the MAX light rail system accessible to all. I don't know how many of you remember the initial wayside lifts, and that was going to truly become a very big problem. My wife recognized that and rallied and worked with a lot of other people to demonstrate to the board that we needed to have the most modern of systems available, and steps were just not going to make this system work. And I think we would all agree that that is truly a very important act that the board had taken on that. And my wife had some small part in influencing that decision, and I'm very proud of her in doing that. Most recently, there are two bridges actually in Southwest Portland, the Tillicum Bridge that you people have built and have recently opened. And unfortunately, my wife was not able to enjoy going across it, but I did, and I do. And we participated in the naming process for that. I didn't get my name selected. I wanted a non-white woman to get the name, and I voted for Sacagawea, or Sacagawea, however you want to pronounce it. My wife voted, but I'm not sure who she voted for as well. I'm very pleased with how that has come out, both as a structure and as a name. The other structure in Southwest Portland that catches my attention is the Darlene Hooley Bridge that connects the Corbett Lyre Hill neighborhood down to the base loading area for the tram. And I think there is a real nexus and a connection there to my wife's involvement in the Sunset Transit Bridge. And I viewed that personally as a Metro Councilor with her when she saw that that had been omitted from the plans and worked with her Metro Councilors and with the TriMet staff to find the money and the engineering wherewithal to get that structure built. And again, I think that that is a truly important structure that you've put up there. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Comments or questions for these folks, just real quickly? So thank you very much for your request and being here. I think probably some of you know I work with Terry a lot in Washington County and other things, and we didn't always see eye to eye on issues, but she was definitely a tireless advocate for the environment, for good land use planning, and for alternative modes of transportation, and most of all for access for people with disabilities. So it's a valid request. Mr. General Manager, again, enlighten me where what we have for don't have for policies on this particular issue.
So, Mr. Board President, members of the board, I share your history of working with Terry in a number of circumstances, and I would also tell you that this bridge, I think, might not actually have ever come onto the table if it wasn't for Terry's advocacy. That said, we do not have a naming policy, and so what I would recommend to the board is that you direct me to come back to the board with a naming policy and have this consideration be considered in light of that policy that is to be developed. I think it's important, actually, that as we do this, it's been a little, frankly, hit and miss in the past. I think that we do need a chance to sort of make sure that we're being fair and even-handed as we begin to do this. So if that suits you, then I would take on that mantle and come back to you shortly with a recommended policy related to naming of TriMet facilities.
So the overpass bridge is owned by TriMet?
Yes, it is.
Is there anybody else that has a piece of it?
Well, it's certainly
the state or the
state probably doesn't own the facility and isn't responsible for maintaining it. TriMet is, but we do, of course, have an aerial easement, if you will, over the right of way of the Highway 26.
Right. Okay. Thanks.
What's the board think of that that proposal? I'm seeing people
so moved.
Yeah. You think we need a motion on that?
I don't know if you do. I'm trying to get it to move it on.
I don't think we need a motion. I think what we ought to do is just please. I think let's get back. And do you have an idea what shortly means? So these folks have some understanding.
What I'd love to do is actually come back with a draft in about a month.
Okay.
Staff is probably wanting to send daggers and cross my other room to me, but within a month, and then have you review that and hopefully ready for adoption shortly thereafter.
So I'd say stay tuned, and we'll notice you when this is coming back before us. But I appreciate your passion and also your effort to get this on. Obviously, it's been well organized, and I wouldn't put it past anybody who knew Terry to do anything less than what I see here. So congratulations.
I just want to clarify. When you say a month, do you mean to the February business meeting?
Yes.
Okay. Yeah. Wanted to be
I concur with your comments, Mr. Warner, because as you well know, my wife did not go lightly into efforts mm-hmm. without being
yes.
fully prepared.
Yes, yes, okay. Good. Well, thanks again.
Thank you, Ben. Thank you. Thank you.
Okay. All righty. All right, so why don't I have three more for the general public forum. So I'm going to call up Teresa Keshi Sodok and Darla Sturdy. Good morning.
Morning. Good morning, Board. My name is Darla Sturdy, and I know most of you, but a few of you I probably don't. My son was killed in 2003 on a crosswalk out in Gresham, passed a law in 2007, came to the board in 2008, and they didn't know about the law. In 2009, we finally went back to Salem, and they had to go back to every single crosswalk throughout the light rail line and figure out what the changes need to be made. So approximately 80 stations, 45 stations and 80 crosswalks. I haven't been here for a while. I'm all about safety and I've heard a lot of accidents. And I know that when I went down to Salem to pass the law from 1994 to 2006, there was 505 with the light rail. So I am looking for some statistics from 2006 to say 2014 on the same type of situation where they give you the name, places, the name of the driver, all of that. I've been watching the light rail and we have the new trains and the old trains. Well, the old train is what sucked my son underneath the train. And when they get hit, if the old trains is all wide open and the new trains aren't. So what I'd like to see is to get us to the new trains, and then I'd like to see if it's possible to be able to start talking about at each station making railing. So the two trains I think have two different openings as far as where they open. If you have one train, the same style, you can rail the stations, and then when the train comes in, you have it railed, you have a gate, opens up, pedestrians get on and off, and it's much safer. Some people have fallen off at stations, and I just think that there needs to be more safer with that. My son, when I passed the law, they had said that in memorial of him, that each year they would do safety. And they would go through and make changes and make sure the crosswalks were safe throughout the line. So I'd just like to know if that is continued and that we do that, and whether or not we've presented that in front of the board this last year, that we've gone out to the stations. A lot of the stations are made the same, so you only have to go to about 15 or 20 stations and check to see safety. So that's what I'm looking for.
Mr. Yield Manager, I assume that we can get the data together from Ms. Sturdy.
We'd probably want to talk to Ms. Sturdy about doing an actual public records request so that we make sure that we get the right information. That's how we make sure we get the right information
okay.
that you want.
Yeah.
And secondly, the board has been updated on the pedestrian crossing in the last program in the last year, and that does continue. I would note that as we go through the budget in the next year, we'll also continue to look at what level of funding that appropriated for those projects as
okay.
well.
Okay.
So we'll get some information to you and make sure you're aware when we talk about these next. But after you get the information, I would suspect if you see something you want to explore further, we'll see you again.
Okay.
All right.
Thank you very much.
All right. Thank you.
Thank you.
Good morning, members of the TriMet Board and Chairman Warner. I am Teresa Keshi Soto, and I'm here to speak on behalf of OPAL, Bus Riders Unite. I ride buses number 9, 17, 4, 71, and the Max Blue Line. May you all be well this morning. The planning for the implementation of HOP, the e-fair, gives TriMet and TriMet customers a wonderful opportunity to work together to make the system work as smoothly as possible. This will encourage those who don't ride TriMet to use it. Opal Bus Riders Unite is concerned about the small number of persons who participated in TriMet forums through social service agencies. The 140 people who participated in these forums is not a number that accurately reflects the concerns and opinions of the many people who ride the bus. Thank you, Mr. Prosser, for suggesting the TriMet do outreach in places where people gather naturally, such as churches. Mr. Edmonds, thank you for also pointing out that this is indeed a low number. Listening to transit-dependent people's concerns and finding solutions will go a long way toward getting a higher percentage of riders to use e-fare. I would like for the board to please consider creating a family fare. Many families depend on public transportation. I was thinking, for example, how expensive it would be for a family of two parents and five children to go on the bus, on the MAX, from outer southeast Portland to the zoo, and it came out to a total of $22.50 just for transportation. I look to the board to take a step on behalf of large families who are often living on low incomes. Please give these families the opportunity to experience public transit at a reasonable cost. And I would love to see them leave their SUVs and take public transportation. In closing, let me say that HOP is a wonderful tool for encouraging the car riding community to leave their cars and take public transit. Please slow down the implementation of HOP to address all issues and concerns that come before you. TriMet, you can be the very best. I urge all of you on the board to take public transit for a whole month to do everything. You will then understand why I am here over and over and over again. I'm now going on my fifth year, and it's been really wonderful. Thank you.
Thank you very much for your input and your advice. Any questions for, go ahead.
No questions, but I want to comment.
Please, okay.
I would like to get, not today, all the hours and costs spent to do this outreach. So we have a baseline, as they say. Okay. Thanks. Okay.
All right, thank you very much.
Thank you.
All right. And the last person I have that's signed up is Chris Walker. There we are. Good morning, Chris.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Wanted to talk to you guys about something about snow service. Watching the news, talking back to the TV, realized there was no, the spokespeople for TriMet never mentioned lift service or streetcar because as a Lyft person who uses Lyft, I'm smart enough to use the phone, but I can only imagine for those who have to plan for group homes or other places where there's more people, it's harder to figure out what's going on. And I know that they can call the phone line, but it's much easier to have it already out there on the air and on the radio and on television. So just noticing that was missed and wondering if we can make sure again that when we have a service issue where something is canceled, that we are for sure mentioning that in all of our platforms.
It's a good comment, Chris. And I suspect we're trying to do that, right, Mr. General Manager?
Thank you, Chris. Appreciate it. All of the press releases and notices to the media that I saw did inform about the changes to the lift service, which was on, I think, that particular Sunday that we had the ICE event, life-sustaining trips only. And again, the website was also updated. When we send it out, it doesn't necessarily mean the media is on the uptake in terms of actually repeating that message. But I think the admonition is a good one, and we should probably work with the media to make sure they know how important that continued message is, and we will do that. I would note that the streetcar, we do also include notices about the streetcar, but recall that the streetcar is a service of the City of Portland, so the key decisions about service and in that case, they actually suspended service until I believe it was in the midday Monday. Those are their decisions, and we're not necessarily party to that, but we will try to make sure that those are incorporated in our notices as well, because again, our customers don't always see the distinction between the management. But just to note that there is a little bit of a difference there.
Good. All right, that's all I have who have signed up for the public forum this morning. And I do have a couple other folks who signed up for the ordinance, so we'll get to that. But is there anybody who missed the sign up but wanted to talk with us this morning? No, is he coming? No, he's leaving. So with that, we'll conclude the public forum, and I will call then to order the Board of Directors' normal business meeting and briefing for Wednesday, January 27th, 2016, to order. So let's move right into then board reports. And I'm going to turn right to Director Lori Irish-Bauman to give us a little update on what the Committee on Accessible Transportation dealt with the last meeting.
Yes, thank you. I'm honored to give my first report as a new liaison to the CAT committee. You have in your packet reports on the highlights of the last two meetings in November and January, and I will give you a recap of the January meeting, which took place on January 20th. First, Lieutenant Rachel Andrew of the Transit Police provided an update on the Transit Police activity and responded to committee members' questions. Judy Wilkie of this Chief Operating Officer of Ride Connection gave an overview of Ride Connection services and an update on its new programs. The CAT discussed budget priorities for fiscal year 17 and agreed to compile a final list of priorities at its March meeting. And finally, Jennifer Kuser, Manager of Community Affairs, provided updates on the Orange Line crossing treatments in response to the committee's concerns and the status of the BRT development for Powell and Division. Thank you.
No, thank you. Any questions for Director Bauman? Seeing none, let's move on then to the Accountability Committee. Director Bethel.
Good morning, Mr. President, again, and all board members. Good morning to everyone else. To talk about the Accountability Committee, I'm just super excited about what's happening with the Accountability Committee. We had our first meeting this past last Friday, which we reviewed our transparency statistics. There were 464 page views of the Accountability Center site in the last 30 days, 464 views, compared with 440 in the preceding month, which is slightly up by 24. For the first time, TriMet's organizational chart was the most viewed page on the Accountability Center. This was followed by TriMet's performance dashboard. The third highest viewed page was information regarding TriMet committees, then the 2015 audited financials, and the top five was rounded out with fiscal year 2016 budget. We also looked at a few samples of video from recent board meetings and briefings. Not only is the quality of the picture and audio very high, but I must also inform you that it catches every move that we make. Unfortunately, it's there. So we are alive and we are not Memorex. The quality is very good, the audio is very high, and we're pleased to see that we have several dozen people who are live streaming at the time when we're doing this, and each meeting, and well over 100 views of the board meetings on average afterwards. So we are, it's working. In summary, the live streaming seems to be fulfilling its purpose of providing broader access and greater transparency of TriMet board meetings. We also looked at TriMet.org, the website itself, in some detail, updating some materials as well as looking for any gaps in information provided so that we could fill those, making the page and the website more user-friendly and giving the information that our customers need. And beginning this year, 2016, the accountability community, that's a new one. Yeah, I kind of like that, because we are community when we meet. Committee, we will meet at least twice a year. If something comes up in the meantime between these meetings, we certainly will have a meeting. So our next meeting is scheduled to be June 17th of this year. That's all I have for the transparency.
That's a lot.
Questions?
That's a lot. Yeah. Appreciate it. Questions from the board?
I just want to say thank you for that report. I think it's good to see that the website is being utilized. I guess I'm going to have to watch one of the streaming videos, though, however, to understand what you're saying there. So be careful.
Yeah, you front and center.
Yeah, thank you so much, John.
Well, I was thinking we should ask Dr. Bethel to give us a cheat sheet of what movements to make and what not to make.
There we go.
Oh, and by the way.
Thank you very much, Cena.
Okay.
All right. Dr. Bethel, would you like to continue with the Transportation Equity Advisory Committee?
Yes, we'll follow right into that. And that TIAC met this past week. The main subject, again, as lady from Opal talked about, is the fare structure. There's been some discussions on the creation or idea of a family-type pass and what that means and if that's possible. This past one, we talked about fare enforcement. That issue came up again. What can be done to reduce the instances around the fare enforcement and fare evasion? Question came up, what's happening with citations? What's the process? How do they go? Someone mentioned, one of the members, that there is something known as TriMet Tuesdays, and everybody wanted to know, what's a TriMet Tuesday? That's the day when most of the TriMet cases are held, and what is that like? And that, so we're seeking more information on that. One other question that came up that I raised in the transparency meeting and got an answer, but I've not had an opportunity yet to go back to TIAC to report, is that someone posed that our app, the mobile phone app, was having issues. The person was saying they were experiencing issues with loading their fares. We did find out that in the earlier part, there was a few issues, mainly with Android. Because Android has so many different applications, and trying to program for each one, there was some issues. But the group has been working on that, and we don't think that that is a real major, major issue at this time. So we will be reporting that back to TIAC in our next meeting. But that's about it for transit equity at this time. Are there any questions?
Yes.
Put your hand down, Jim.
Excuse me. Yes, Dr. Bethel. Do you have stats on people riding or violations of the fare? Are they going up and down? Is there a steady, anything like that, if you have?
I don't personally have that to give you accurate, mm-hmm. but just a sum total of a couple of things. If you remember, several months back, we talked about it here, mm-hmm. in our board meeting,
yes,
because,
sir.
Of an issue of an article that was in Street Roots. And I think at that time, there was some work beginning to be done by the equity department. So I can't tell you that, but we will look for that information and try to get that back to you.
Thank you.
And Mr. General Manager, you and then our diversity person is here. I don't know if.
Exactly. I just wanted to mention that we do have this scheduled for a much more thorough briefing, the whole those statistics and many others. I believe it's scheduled now for your March briefing, one of your March meetings. So we'll go into it in quite some depth at that point. But we can certainly get that information to you in the meantime.
Yeah, I had a good conversation on Christmas Eve with a lot of the inspectors that just happened to be riding downtown, and had four of them, and so had some insight into that. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Mr. President.
Appreciate it. Director Martin, the Metro Policy Advisory Committee.
Good morning, everybody. As far as transportation at Metro, what we discussed is obviously putting in the Orange Line or the extra transportations is really great for businesses and making sure that the general public can get around. The other piece to this is what the oversight is to make sure that we're not overstepping affordable housing. So making sure part of our planning as we're going in, they talked about purchasing buildings that can be converted and staying in an affordable housing piece, so we're not pricing out the very people that are wanting public transportation. So as we move forward in our growth, to make sure that is included in our planning. In summary, that's about all that in the last month we had it through the holidays is what was discussed as involving transit. Thank you.
Questions for Director Martin? Mm-hmm. Thank you very much. And that was your first meeting?
There's been about four, but that was the first one that was really transit involved.
All right, good. All right. Okay, the last board report is the Finance and Audit Committee. Director Prosser?
Yes, the Finance Committee met this morning. We had a presentation from our Chief Financial Officer, Dee Brookshire, on some updated financial forecast assumptions. As you know, they're working on the financial forecast leading to the preparation of the budget. And they're updating some of the assumptions based on the most recent economic data. One other thing that we talked about is TriMet has used the services of a economic forecasting consultant for several years. This year, the staff is looking at low-cost ways to get an outside economist, not associated with the firm, just to take a look at the forecast and validate the projections. Basically, another set of eyes, which I think is an excellent way to go, and will give us a little bit more confidence in that forecast. Dee also updated us on the budget process. Budget requests have been coming in from departments, and will very soon, like this afternoon, land on our general manager's desk. And so the budget process is moving along. I'm pleased about that. And we did go through the investment policy, had some discussion about some of the changes, which are relatively minor and just brings us into compliance with comments made by the Oregon Short-Term Fund Board, which is state-level committee managed by the state treasurer that oversees all local investment policies. And also a little bit of discussion about the strategic finance plan policies and how those come in. We were also briefed by the general manager on some issues related to resolution 160107, which will be coming up on our regular agenda, dealing with the purchasing process. So we had a little in-depth discussion about that, and there will be some comments that I know I'm willing to offer regarding that, so we can deal with that in a little more detail at that time. So that is the action of the Finance Committee. If there are any questions, I'd be glad to answer them.
Any questions from the board for Director Prosser? All right, thank you. I think it was a very valuable meeting this morning. Thank you for the summary. Okay, with that, I'm going to turn down to the General Manager's report. Mr. General Manager.
Board President, members of the board, good morning. I just wanted to make one comment in response to some of the comments you've heard and to Director Esmond's question about outreach. And I just wanted to sort of emphasize that related to the HOP program, the outreach is really just beginning. And one of the considerations in the budget this next year will be a much more thorough, if you will, outreach program related to communicating with our potential customers and all that. And so you'll begin to hear a bit more about that as we go through the budget deliberations as well.
Bruce? Mm-hmm.
that was never intended. I don't want to portray it as a criticism.
Understand. Understand. I was just attempting to elaborate a little bit more, perhaps I should have.
I'm sympathetic because in my other job, I do a lot of that. And if you have the key to break through that, I appreciate it.
Yeah, I appreciate that. I did want to start by just giving you an update on our initiatives related to MAC's on-time performance. As you know, this is a major emphasis of the agency. And, you know, I'm sort of, again, apologize to our customers to the extent that we disappoint them. And, for example, we had a service interruption last night on the Steel Bridge. I actually believe our service team responded quite well with a number of the bus bridges and a good service to our customers. Given that we had a wire down across the Steel Bridge that was repaired by about 5:30 or so, and service then was restored. But I would just note, in a general sense, our primary message is to provide safe and reliable service, and so we continue to really focus on that. I would just note that it's a highly complex system. We operate 22 and a half hours a day. We have 145 vehicles. We have over 60 miles of right-of-way, and we're averaging right now a little bit better than 80% on-time performance, but our goal is 90, so we're continuing to focus on that. You might recall that this actually was an initiative that were originally organized by Bob Nelson. I would just note that our new Chief Operating Officer, Doug Kelsey, has brought additional and new energy and good thoughts to this. So I think you'll continue to see some progress in this front. Indeed, we actually saw a 90% day on Sunday, 91% on-time performance. So we're beginning to see some improved performance day by day. But it is a day by day process for our operations staff. Just to augment this information a little bit, we find as we drill down into the information that about 2/3 of the delays are actually things that you could sort of consider in our control. That is equipment failures or right-of-way failures, signals or switches. And about 1/3 are those that really come from outside sources, perhaps a medical incident with a customer, perhaps a police action somewhere along the line that focuses us a stop, perhaps an auto crashing into the right-of-way and perhaps being difficult to remove from the situation. So what we're trying to do is obviously reduce the number of delays that are associated with our activities, and then also speed up the response and the clearing of incidents that that we are not responsible for ourselves. And I would note that even in our current capital plan, we have some very aggressive improvement programs related to the MAC system, currently budgeted over the next calendar year about $11 million worth of signal and track replacement programs, for example. And that will continue as we see, to really make sure that we're offering the best service we can. As happened last night, we do see sort of an overlapping set of problems around the Steel Bridge. So one of the contracts that you'll consider here later today is a much more thorough in-depth engineering study of all of the switches and signals and configurations around the Steel Bridge, with the goal of identifying the strategies and programs that will help make that not quite the bottleneck that it has been in the past for our customers. But that, too, is exceptionally complex. As many of you know, the Steel Bridge is actually owned by the Union Pacific Railroad. The lease of the top deck is actually the master leases with ODOT, and we are a sublessee to ODOT. So there's both contractually in terms of the operations of this 100-plus-year-old bridge is a complex situation, but it is important for us to really focus on how to make sure that service is of the highest quality as it is a critical link for us right now. I'd also note that we've been meeting with a number of our other partners in this area. One meeting that I was able to call was in response to an incident that made me incredibly nervous during a Christmas concert that I was attending this year. But we had a tree fall across part of 6th Avenue here in downtown. And what was making me so nervous about that was that it actually took city forces 4 hours to respond to that. So we've now cleared the deck, if you will, so that we can bring out our own chainsaws in these circumstances to make sure we clear the right-of-way in a much more expeditious way. So those sorts of protocols are what we really need to work through with not only the City of Portland, which have been incredibly cooperative about this and actually share our values of keeping MACs moving, but also with all the other jurisdictions that we work with as well. So what I wanted to do is give you that quick update and note that we'll continue to report to you on all of our improvements related to on-time performance. And happy to answer any questions on that topic, if you will.
Go ahead.
On the issue of Steel Bridge,
yes.
I know that you're aware that I have a lot of concerns about the bridge, particularly related to earthquake stability. You know, the fact that four of our MAX lines cross that bridge, so many buses, and as we see with these service issues, when that bridge goes out, that really is a major issue. I would like to see us talking about that more with our partners, with the ODOT and Union Pacific, with City of Portland, because when things happen on that bridge, it has such significant impact. I'm also interested in whether TriMet should start exploring alternatives to that bridge. Right now, other than Telecom Crossing, which just carries the Orange Line, it's the only way for our trains to get across the river. Do we need to start looking at either a line that we could come down the east side to get to Telecom so that we could get lines across if something happens to the bridge? Should we be looking at alternative new crossings? I just remain concerned because, you know, I see these issues. I worry about major events in the future, and I don't get the sense that our partners. I don't get the sense that it's something that they're even aware of, quite honestly. So, just I'm hoping there's something we can do to keep pushing that issue and move it forward.
I agree with all those sentiments, and I would also just note that I think the solutions need to be lined up short-term, mid-term, long-term, and that we need to be really beginning a work program on all of those. Yeah. So,
good comments. Director Edlin?
A while back, there was a statistic or a figure in the paper. Since the problems at the Port of Portland, how many more semis have clogged our roads, and of course that would impact our level of service. So I've heard 2,000, and I wouldn't disbelieve that.
So that's about the number that I recollect, but okay. My brain's very foggy about that. 2,000 to 3,000 is what I recall.
Yeah,
but we can certainly.
I don't need it. Yeah, I just want to make sure the audience knows that things have. We're doing everything we can, so. Yeah. But this is outside our jurisdiction, so thanks.
Any other comments, or should I proceed, Mr. Board President?
I think I just want to follow up on what Director Prosser said. I mean, the steel bridge is a problem. There's no question about that. And I think we talk about infrastructure funding and preservation of the systems and how what we need to do. I mean, if I remember right, I don't think any of the bridges going over the Willamette River, except for the Telecom Crossing, would be standing after a mid to moderate or to large earthquake. And, you know, that's pretty scary when you get down to it. So I know that people are starting to think about that, and I think that we do need to figure out a way to how to address the steel bridge. But I think an overall strategy would be about where our lifelines are and what we need to do to improve our lifelines over the Willamette River is pretty doggone important. I hope that does get some attention as we move forward in future years.
Appreciate that.
Yeah. All right. So please proceed.
I also wanted to give you an Orange Line safety update. This is something the board, I know, wanted to keep its eye on, and we'll, of course, give you a much more thorough reports as time goes on. But what I can tell you is that we're delivering a very safe experience for our riders. And again, I think Harry briefed you previously on the security plans prior to opening, and we have been following through with those plans, working with all the local jurisdictions, as well as the Transit Police Department, our own supervisory force, fare inspectors, our G4S contract, all elements of that overall plan. We can tell you at this point in time, we've had about 865,000 trips taken in the first 90 days of the Orange Line, and there were 45 incidents. So an incredibly small proportion, and most of those were a result of TriMet code enforcement. So in other words, our trying to sort of be preemptory in terms of making sure that there are not safety incidents that begin to develop on the line. So again, I note that Harry will bring you a full safety and security update at your April meeting with the annual statistics and the review that we have traditionally done. But I did want to give you that window into, frankly, a very safe first 3 months of the Orange Line operation. And again, any questions on that, I'd be happy to answer.
Can you, what is the TriMet code enforcement?
That would be fair. That would be any sorts of
conduct
that was
so that falls into prohibited. The safety issue.
So those would be a security issue, I would say, okay. More than a safety issue. Yeah.
Okay. Thank you.
Yeah. Let me just continue then. You might note that you have an item on your consent agenda, which I did want to just address very briefly because it's one step in an ongoing process, which has to do with the Special Transportation Fund Advisory Committee, or in our lingo, STFAC. So the STFAC is a state-designated body that you appoint the members to. And they do allocate funds to different nonprofit organizations or public transit providers to provide enhanced services for seniors or people with disabilities. This has been a very collaborative, cooperative process. The state regulations have categories of membership that are outlined in your resolution. We've been working closely with nonprofit providers like Ride Connection and others, as well as our own Committee on Accessible Transportation and many others. There are some, supplemental funds that became available after the legislature adjourned and did the final budget reconciliations. And so that's what the STFAC is meeting on right now, to sort of allocate those additional supplemental funds. And that recommendation will ultimately come back to you as a board for approval and actual distribution. But the other thing that I wanted to just mention to you is that the other role for the STFAC is to help us develop something called the Coordinated Transportation Plan, which is a federal requirement and one that helps guide the delivery of these services across the region. That plan is due for update, and so we will be working with STFAC as well as others to update that plan over the next 6 months, and then that will ultimately come back to the board for approval as well. We currently think that's more likely June or so of this year that will be back to you. So I just wanted to let you know that stream of activities is underway and how that resolution fits into that overall. And if there are no specific questions about that, I'd ask Dee perhaps to come up to provide the quarterly finance report.
Mr. General Manager.
Question. Yep. Thank you, Mr. President. Mr. General Manager, thank you so much for bringing up that resolution 1601, I think, whatever that long acronym you have, Fund Advisory Committee. Because when I looked at the resolution, there's a couple of things that I would like to, it talks about making sure that there is diversity and representation on there. It's very hard to determine what's on that committee because they have no bio information. There's a couple of names I know because of work with the others. It's just, you're just asking us to, kind of reach in a bag and say, okay, all the apples in this bag are good. I would like to request, even after we've done this, some bio information to know who the person are that we are appointing. I think it would be good responsibility to know you appointed you know, Petunia. I like to use the name Petunia because most folks say, I don't know about the name Petunia. Well, I happen to have known a female named Petunia. She's a one of a kind. So I would like to see that. And secondly, I would like to ask for the vacancies that are there to do everything that's possible to try to get some other representation from some of our other communities to be a part of that, because they have issues as well sometimes that are not always represented in the correct way or the depth and the passion that we do have with you know, others who sit on that committee.
Agree with both of those comments. We'll get the bio information to you. And my mention, just to augment your notion about the vacancies, I think that's incredibly important to help achieve that sort of diversity and full input of the community. And would note that we have been working with a lot of our nonprofit partners to sort of find good representatives for that. And if the board would have any suggestions on that, that would be terrific too. Because of the timing of the funding, we do need to move forward with the allocation. But again, we do want to fill out those vacancies with the goals that you noted and very much in the front of our mind as we do so.
Thank you very much. And I do appreciate the amount of outreach that was done for this committee.
I appreciate it.
Good morning.
The report you received with your board material provided the second quarter results for fiscal year 2016 that closed on December 31st, 2015. And this puts us halfway through the current fiscal year, and the numbers are starting to give us a stronger look and basis for the year-end projections we're using in our financial modeling. All numbers that I'm going to be giving you are year-to-date, and this presentation will take you through the financial reports hitting the high points, so please feel free to stop me at any time if you have any questions. And the larger overview is that total revenues for the year are lower than budget by $1.3 million, and that total operating expenses are $14 million lower than budget. And so that combined with the system operating expenses of being under budget by 3.1, the total net results for the operations are better than budget by $15.8 million. And I'm going to give you some of the reasons for that. So our payroll tax revenue is slightly lower than budget for the first half of the year. However, compared to the same quarter last year, payroll tax revenue has grown 11.7%. We are straight lining the budget, so this is not unexpected. We expect the receipts actually vary from year to year or month to month. So we're not concerned about that. So passenger revenue for fiscal year to date is 0.9% lower than budget. And operating grant revenue year to date totals $31.9 million, of which $29.2 million was federal operating grants associated with prior year costs. We expect to receive $78.9 million in federal operating grant funds this year, but because these revenues are recorded as federal grants, as they are approved by the FTA, funds are appropriated, the revenues are recorded as the federal grants are approved by the FTA, and sometimes that approval is a little hard to predict. We may not receive all the money that we're expecting this year, but we should receive it soon after. On the system operating side, the quarter system operating expenses for the quarter are 6.3% under budget, $14 million of that, with $9 million of the variance occurring in the operations division. So operations personnel services expenses was less than budget by $3.1 million. In bus transportation, field operations, rail transportation, bus maintenance, and rail maintenance of way. Our diesel fuel expense was less than budget by $3.5 million. Maintenance materials were less than budget by $1.4 million. The remainder of variance was due to timing differences in receipts. So we've taken some steps in the budget planning process for fiscal year 2017 to narrow the budget to actual variance in the area by reducing the budget for fuel, reducing the inflationary increase on materials and supplies where possible to 1%, and we're considering including an offset in personal services to account for the vacancy factor the agency experiences in operations every year. Operating project expenses include repairs and maintenance to existing infrastructure, and these expenses are less than budget also by $3.1 million for fiscal year to date. We expect this will be spent on operating projects before the year ends, but this is an area that we're paying close attention to because it's recurring. We're always running under budget in this area, and it's you've commented on it from time to time. So working with our new capital projects committee, we are taking a very close look at the budgets for all the projects, and if we're not using the funding, we're going to reallocate to other projects where there is work that can be done, that we can move on quickly. So now I'd like to move on to TriMet's general fund debt service activity. That's on page 8 of the reports that you have, in case you are following along. Our debt service payments are mainly paid with payroll tax receipts and a few other general fund revenue sources, such as the Metropolitan Transportation Investment Program, MTIP, federal funds received from Metro, and to some degree, our federal 5307 funds. We deposit payments to our debt service funds every month, and so through December, those totaled $25.7 million, while principal and interest payments to bondholders and leaseholders totaled $33.3 million for the same time frame. The December 31 balance in debt service restricted accounts is $30.5 million, and again, all related activity to that is found on page 8. Statement of capital contributions and capital expenditures. Our total capital expenditures, including our light rail program expenditures, are $48.2 million for the first 6 months of the current fiscal year. This includes $28.5 million spent on the PMLR project. TriMet has received the first four installment payments under the full funding grant agreement for the PMLR project, and those total $379.5 million. Our FFGA receipt schedule anticipates three more annual payments of $100 million through 2018 and one final payment in 2019 of $65,664,144. So we expect to receive the 2016 payment in the fourth quarter of fiscal year 2016. So you will find a lengthy statement of capital contributions that we are required by accounting rules to provide you on page 9, that in short says that we cannot record capital contributions received from outside sources, such as our funding partners on PMLR, until the contribution terms are met. So almost all funds have been spent on the project. However, there is a small portion that remains in a deferred contribution account. As a result of this, the negative net cost of capital acquisitions is negative $25.7 million for the fiscal year to date. And you'll see that on the small table in the lower right-hand corner of page 5 and also on page 9. Finally, the statement of net position in a very condensed explanation measures the difference between total assets plus deferred outflows and total liabilities plus deferred inflows of TriMet resources. TriMet's net total net position at December 31 is nearly $2 billion. Our current assets have increased $30.8 million in the first half of the fiscal year due to the receipt of the restricted cash from this year's bond issue. With respect to the non-current assets, the value of property and equipment increased by $21.9 million. Total liabilities have increased $32.1 million since June 30th. Our long-term debt increased $59.5 million due to the issuance of the new money portion of the 2015 bonds. Unearned capital project revenue has decreased $21.8 million as we've used the funds for capital projects, and our OPEB liability has increased $23.7 million since June 30th, with $498.7 million showing as a non-current liability on that balance sheet. Excuse me. Our long-term lease liability has decreased $11.6 million. Our net pension liability decreased $5.4 million to $172.1 million since June due to regular payments on the pension trust. Our current liabilities have decreased $30 million since June 30th as a result of payments on invoices and other payables accrued at year end. And in closing, I'd like to give you a few notes on TriMet's investment portfolio starting on page 11. The December investment portfolio report shows $91.6 million of unrestricted cash and investments, which represents cash and short-term investments available to TriMet for operations, and $215.4 million in restricted cash and investments restricted to debt service and capital projects. $95.5 million of these investments is restricted specifically for use on PMLR. So this concludes my report on the second quarter financials. Any questions on any of that?
I'm looking here. Is there any questions by the board? There's a lot of information. Thank you. A good summary, I think. Everybody okay?
Okay.
I didn't see any questions. I think.
Good. I did want to update you on one more thing, and that was, and I shared this with the Finance and Audit Committee this morning, and that is that we are looking at the opportunity to take advantage of the current volatility in the marketplace, if you will, to refund some of the 2012 bonds. And so this could result in as much as a 6% savings over time on that issue. And we're talking about a small refunding issue, no new money, of upwards of about $40 million. So we've received proposals from each member of our underwriting pool, and so we'll be evaluating those today. And we'll let you know as we move forward, but we will move forward fairly quickly. You did grant authorization for us to seek refunding opportunities, so we will just update you as we go along.
So the cap that we put on that is adequate to deal with what you're looking at?
Yes.
Okay, good. That's good news. Good luck on that one. Always luck.
I do have one other comment, which was a shout out to our Capital Projects Executive Director, Dan Walker. So Dan was named here in the last week one of the top 25 newsmakers in the country by Engineering News Record. And ENR, as it's known in our business, is really one of the key publications that really track the construction industry overall. The efforts were really related to the effort on the whole PMLR project, but certainly on a telecom crossing, to anticipate problems and keep the project moving and building a very collaborative arrangement between project staff and our contractors and our consultants that really meant for the smooth delivery of that project under budget and on time. So again, congratulations to Dan. This is, again, a very high honor, and in front of 25 that the magazine editors have selected, there is another layer of the contest where they'll select from that 25 the highest honor, which is their award of excellence on an annual basis, and so we all have our fingers crossed for Dan. And with that, Mr. President, concludes my report.
Well deserved.
Congratulations.
Here, here. Yeah.
Yep.
I would have expected him to sit closer to the front with that type of recognition. Good job.
Is that why he shaved his beard off, Neil?
I think that had something more to do with snorkeling. But I
know. Okay.
All right. Yeah, congratulations. Congratulations to the whole team.
But yeah, right.
It is a whole team that made that project so very successful. So Dan, please pass on our thanks to everybody else, too. All right. Thank you. All right. So any other further questions from the board on the reports? All right. Then let's move to the consent agenda. And we have seven items on our consent agenda. And for anybody listening on this, the items on the consent agenda are considered to be routine and may be approved by the board in one blanket motion. However, any board member may remove an item from the consent portion of the agenda for discussion or questions by requesting such action prior to consideration of this portion of the agenda. And real quickly, I'll just let anybody who wants to know what those seven items, very routine, approval of the minutes from our last meeting, a resolution directing that all ordinances be read by title only, a resolution adopting a revised investment policy, which are, I believe, bookkeeping changes. But we did have a good discussion at the Finance and Audit Committee. Director Prosser had some questions. We talked a little bit about the resolution, which is amending the Special Transportation Fund Advisory Committee bylaws and ratifying and appointing members. Dr. Bethel, you had some questions. I don't know whether those satisfied you being able to move forward, but we'll find out in a moment here. Then we had a resolution authorizing a contract with pavement services for asphalt pavement maintenance program design services, a resolution authorizing a contract with Schneider PermaCurbs to provide on-call asphalt sealing contract services, and then finally, a resolution authorizing a contract with OTAC, which is an engineering firm, for the survey, right-of-way, mapping, and GIS integration services. So that's the consent agenda. Is there anything on the consent agenda that any of the other board members have any questions about, or anything that the board member items the board would like to have removed?
I've got one question.
Okay.
I don't need anything removed.
All right.
Just on the resolution that involved permacurb, it just seemed, I mean, the difference between, frankly, the lowest bidder and the other two bids was quite significant. I mean, do we have an idea of why that was? Were the specs something that they didn't actually understand? Because then our own individual cost estimate was even lower than the actual lowest bid.
I'm glad that you asked that, because that was actually a question I asked as we put this together. And the answer was, sort of twofold. One is that the recommended contractor actually has been doing these services for some time, so has a very high level of knowledge based on past performance, and has also right-sized a number of equipment purchases to be very efficient related to the configurations that we have. The second, and I think it's probably perhaps more important, is that the recommended contractor actually provides their own asphalt product, if you will, to use, and so are able to have some cost advantage because of that supply chain being under consistent ownership, if you will. And so those are the two reasons that were provided by our contract staff as they asked that same question, frankly, of both the recommended contractor and those that also provided bids to us.
Excellent. Thank you.
All right, then. Seeing no other questions, is there a motion then to approve the consent agenda as presented?
So moved, Mr. President.
Have a motion.
Second.
Have a second. All right, any further discussion? All right, with that, I'll call the question. All those in favor of the motion to approve the consent agenda, please signify by saying aye.
Aye. Aye.
Any opposed? Any abstentions? Seeing none, the motion is approved unanimously. Thank you. Let's move on then to resolutions. First resolution is resolution 16-01-06, which is authorizing a contract with Global Signals Group Incorporated for on-call rail signal engineering, testing, and commissioning support services. Mr. General Manager.
Hey, Mr. Board President, members of the board, you might recall that as we did our service enhancement plans around the region and focusing on the west side, that first of those service enhancement plans we did, one of the major requested and high demand improvements to service was the extension of the red line from the current terminus at Beaverton Transit Center out to Fairplex. By accomplishing that, we actually provide a great deal of more commuter service, frankly, in both directions, but also to some of the major employment sectors in Washington County, including the Nike campus and Intel and many other employers in the Hillsborough and North Hillsborough area. So it provides, it also helps even the loads, if you will, on the inbound direction toward downtown. So we think that's a very high quality improvement to the system that we would really like to advance. And so this is the first step in advancing that. In order to be able to provide that service on a daily basis, we do need end of the line, the creation of end of a red line station, if you will, at Fairplex, and that would include automatic signals as well as operator support facilities. The notion of sort of automating the switches and changing the signals around might sometimes sound simple, but it's a very complex undertaking that then needs to be reflected back in our central control area and in all the operations of the system. So this contract is essentially to help us design those improvements and then to be on board as they are constructed to make sure that they're constructed in a way that actually provides a high level of safety and security as we make these changes in our operation. Our current plan is to do the design this year, the construction next year, and follow up with operations in the following year. We'll be looking at that schedule in the budget process because we do know that this is a highly desirable service that we'd like to put in place as soon as we can. And again, that service would be paid for and funded out of the increments of the payroll tax that you approved last September. In terms of the actual procurement of this project, again, Global Signals Group Inc. scored the highest related particularly to personnel experience, but also had, I think, very good quality and responses in all of the other categories. And again, we have experts here who could answer more detailed questions about this contract, but I would recommend your approval.
All right. Any questions of staff on this item? Seeing none, then.
So what's...
Go ahead.
Okay. So what's... I'm sorry.
It's all right.
The value is how much? A million?
Yes.
Okay. Over 5 years?
Over 5 years.
Okay. So how far is it to the out to the Hillsboro Fairplex Future Station ballpark?
Can somebody tell me?
Somebody.
I think it's about 4 miles.
Four
I would
miles.
Bet. Well, how about if we let
that's
you know
close enough.
After?
Yeah. Okay. Thanks. Nope. I'm good.
Okay,
Mr. President.
I don't see any other questions. Is there a motion then to approve Resolution 16?
I'll make a motion.
Six. I have a motion.
Second.
I have a second. Any further discussion before we act? All right, well, with that, all those then in favor of the motion to approve Resolution 16-01-06, please signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Any opposed? Any abstentions? Hearing none, the motion is approved unanimously. All right, let's move on to Resolution 16-01-07. Which is authorizing a modification to a contract with Innovations in Transportation, Inc. for additional computer-aided bus dispatch and radio system hardware, and an increase in the change order allowance. And I would point out that I think you received from Kelly a revised agenda item, and also is there a copy of it in the information in your packet or in the separate packet out this morning. And Mr. General Manager, may I turn it over to you and explain the differences and what we have here on this item.
Very good, Mr. Board President, members of the board. I'm a little sheepish with this one. I think for the first time that I ever remember, we are actually over our skis on contract authority with this particular contract. So I wanted to first of all acknowledge that right up front, and as soon as we learned of this, we brought it here to your attention today. But I would tell you that this is an incredibly important contract for us, and it's also a very complex contract. It was established in 2009 to replace then our computer-aided dispatch as well as our radio system. And that was under a number of, if you will, requirements, one of which that our initial first state-of-the-art computer AVL system for our automatic vehicle location system was very rickety and beginning to fall apart. Our radio system was under the requirement to actually be narrow-banded under federal requirements. And we had, frankly, an out-of-date dispatch system that did not do proper service to, frankly, our customers or our operators. So this has been a very important technology project that really, really has been underway since 2009. And when you begin to talk about all of these factors, you begin to see how many parts of the organization this touches. Frankly, that sort of interdivisional nature of this contract was what got us into the situation where we actually are over our skis related to contract authority. But I would also note that we are about $5 million under the current lid, so we are not overspent. But we do like to come to you well in advance of any commitments with the contract and advancing the contract. And that is, of course, our normal practice. And again, I think this is the only time in my period of time as general manager where we have not, where we have frankly failed in that regard. I'd also just note, and if we can certainly provide you some additional details from Dee, but what we have done in relation to this is put in another layer of controls to make sure that we are tracking the authority questions as deeply and as detailed as we track expenditures. Related to the substance here, let me just note that we did have a number of changes to this contract as we moved along, and I think while the basic scope has been implemented quite satisfactorily, we have a number of changes that we also see that are important moving ahead. But a couple of items that we hadn't planned on were the initiation of the ticket printers on the bus, which might now seem like they've been there for a while, and they have, but that was a change from that original 2009 scope. We've also had a growing fleet and a lot of new replacement buses, so hardware associated with those new buses has been part of the changes that drove these costs. I'd also just note that there's a lot of new ahead. Candidly, one of the topics that will be integrated into this is the electronic fare system, and this the system on the bus actually provides the portal for information back to the electronic fare mainframe, if you will, or back end as it's known. So it will be the backbone of transmitting data from the buses to the electronic fare back end. We've also rolled out our radio system, and frankly, it's been real challenging because of the narrow banding requirements and the limitation on the number of channels that are allocated to TriNet. And one of the other things that we're finding is that some of our, for example, inside some of our signal rooms, the signal is not as strong as it needs to be, so we need to do some modifications to make sure that the radios are working at all the safety-sensitive places along the way. So for all of that, in addition to the past roll-up of changes, we have the request for about a 5% change order increase as well. Another of those items that has not been priced but we know we are working on is the sort of real-time CCTV applications that I think Harry has briefed you on in the past in terms of the direction that we're going with being able to handle the increased reliance on video information. I would note that all of this is really important work to be done, important to both our safety, security, fare, and management of the system. And I would contend that, yes, with my tail between my legs, this is coming to you late. I'll hold up my hands for the ruler because it is due, and it would be appropriate. But I'd also note that it's important work that I think in all cases we do need to move forward with. And because of that, I do recommend your approval. And I'd be happy to sort of bring up others involved in this who know more of the details if you'd like to hear some additional information about that. And with that, I'll conclude my report, Mr. Board President.
Well, first off, I guess I want to say thank you for your candor and willingness to admit an error here. We don't like these kind of issues, and frankly, unacceptable. We did have a good discussion at the Finance and Audit Committee this morning, and Director Prosser, I don't know whether you want to make some comments now or get a motion on the table. And
I can make them now, yeah. Okay. As Bruce indicated, we did have bit of a discussion about this at the Finance and Audit Committee, and what I'll say is basically what I said at the committee meeting. Unfortunately, what happened with this contract really is one of my main bugaboos. Earlier in my career, I worked at an organization where this kind of thing was not the exception like it is here, but it was pretty much standard operating procedure. And this kind of thing would come through, it would get to the governing body of that organization, and they'd just pass it, and nobody said anything about rules not being followed, procedures not being followed. And as a result of that experience, I'm very sensitive to purchasing issues. TriMet actually has an excellent purchasing process, and Neil's indicated he hasn't run across this kind of situation here in his time here. I certainly haven't run across it in my time on the board, but nevertheless, this kind of thing should not happen. And I will vote in favor of this resolution. It's an important resolution. The services are important to this organization. This was a mistake. It does need to be corrected, and this board is the only body that can do that. But I also need to make clear my expectation that we will never see something like this again. I have confidence that that will happen, but if it does happen again, I reserve the right to be really prickly. So that's it.
All right.
Other comments? Yep, Dr. Bethel.
Sad that this did happen this way, but again, I will support this because the work is important to move forward. However, I must state that I still have issues within it. From the very beginning, no secret, I didn't think Enid was the group to do this. I'm still struggling with Enid in its diversity and its diversity work. It's a lot of talk, but I don't see anything. I need us to push Enid to be a Nike. Just do it. And if they can't do it, then I think it becomes a very sad thing for us, given where we are today in life, in society, in this world, that if they can't do it, that we continue to reward them more and more and more with the same, we're going to actively look, we're trying to, and nothing comes out of it. So just want that piece on the record. I still have issues within it and its diversity and its inclusion.
Other comments? Director Stovall.
Just so that we fully comprehend the situation that we're looking at here, you referenced that we actually haven't overspent the current amount that's allocated or approved. And the situation that we're looking at here is the board essentially has approved a certain contract level. So we've approved a certain dollar amount. And the requirement is that these things would come back to the board prior to a contract or a change order being signed. And so in this situation, we've had additional change orders signed that have gone above and beyond what the budgeted and approved amount, not budgeted, but the approved amount was. And so essentially, they haven't performed the work, well, they may or may not have, but essentially, we haven't paid for it yet. And we've got the change orders signed, but yet not executed.
That's essentially correct. We're about $5 million under authorized authority in terms of total payments to the contractor. And I would say that progress payments are made on a regular basis. I can't tell you that every element of change hasn't
correct
some payment, but overall we're about $5 million.
Exactly. Yeah. And so there's varying levels of of actions that I would say, and as a board member, would raise my level of concern and the severity of the issue. The highest level would be, if we had gone to the degree where we had actually paid for these services without this additional approval. Another level down would be we've actually signed the change orders and approved them at the staff level without the board approval. That comes down a lower level. Lowest level would be, if we know we're going to go over those amounts and essentially we were intending to sign those change orders but haven't yet. I mean, that's the lowest level of severity in my opinion. I think we're at that second level where it's like, okay, wow, we've signed them. The board actually does have some input to say whether or not we're actually going to move those forward. And then there's the one where I think the most severe is if we've already performed them, already paid for them, and they weren't approved in that scenario. So I see this, if I were looking at it from an audit perspective and using their terminology, it wouldn't be the most extreme situation in that regard. So it's good that we've captured this at this point in time, and the slap on the hand, as you referenced, Neil, is warranted. But I will say, as a board member looking at this situation, in the time that I've been on the board, I mean, these situations like this, I can't remember one. I think you've referenced that. And to that end, I still commend our organization, the leadership that we have, for doing an exemplary job on, on 99% of the work that we do and the work that we commence on. And to say that certainly as these things come up, this is a lower level of concern, in my opinion, something that certainly I feel is going to be addressed at the highest level, and we won't see this again in the future. But I just want to reiterate, you know, specifically for the public that this is, I mean, our team is a phenomenal team. They do great work, and even in situations where they don't exceed our expectations and meet our expectations, they're forthright and forward about the situation, and certainly moving forward, we won't see this happening again. So that Director Prosser won't have to get upset or ticked or anything like that. So, again, I appreciate the transparency that we continue to see in this organization, and welcome the opportunity to move forward beyond this.
I just want to echo what Dr. Bethel said. If we have good intentions and stuff like that, that don't cut it for me as a board member. I'm sure there must be somebody out there, disadvantaged business, minority-owned business, that can get help out on this work. This is a lot of money, and the whole, I wasn't here for the original, but we have a good record of doing this, and I don't want to see this change. So I hope the management will do what management does and get these people to live up to the spirit of what we do here at TriMet.
Good comment. So where are we? I think, you know, as you pointed out, Director Stovall, we are very transparent and open in terms of discussing this and bringing this issue forward. I also am ready to move forward on this because the work does need to be done. But I think Dr. Bethel's concerns ought to be addressed, and maybe this is something we can bring back at a later date to just see how they are doing. Because I think tracking the performance and reporting it does help.
Yes, and happy to do that. And just to note that, again, this contract was actually started before I was in this particular chair as well. So it does have a long history. But related to the electronic fare system contract, we do have a briefing up scheduled for you about the independent assessment review and management related to management and security. We will do a full report back to the board on that because we've had that independent assessment of are we managing it well, given some of the board's concerns about other high-profile technology projects locally. And so that is on the schedule, and we at the same time will report back on the disadvantaged business. But related to the e-fare system, I would just simply say I think we are seeing better progress and better performance from it, and we'll be happy to update the details on that when we get to that briefing, perhaps.
Good. Thank you. With that, is there a motion then to approve Resolution 16-01-07 as amended?
So moved.
Second.
I have a second. Any further discussion? I think we said it all. All those in favor of the motion to approve the revised resolution, the revised report and the resolution for 16-01-07, please signify by saying aye.
Aye. Aye.
Any opposed? Any abstentions? Motion is approved. Thank you. Let's move on then to Resolution 16-01-08, which is authorizing a contract with CH2M Hill, Inc. for assessment and design services for the steel bridge improvements, of which we do have a little interest, as you can see.
Mr. Board President, members of the board, I'm pleased that I was able to anticipate and you were able to express the notion about the urgency and the importance, frankly, of beginning to address some of the issues around the steel bridge. So in that regard, we did issue an RFP for professional engineering services. And as a result of that RFP, we had actually three very qualified firms come back with proposals, and we do recommend the proposal by CH2M Hill. As noted, this is a procurement under the Brooks Act. We've noted to you in the past that what this requires is that we assess the qualifications of the firm first, and then as a second step, have a commercial negotiation with them to see if we can reach satisfactory terms. And again, I'm pleased to say that we were able to do that with CH2M Hill. I'd also just note to the substance and the scope is that this is probably not the end-all and be-all of studies, but it's a great opportunity to begin to address the questions that you've raised in your conversation earlier, begin to peel back, if you will, the onion of the complexity of this bridge that is, again, over 100 years old. I think 1911 was the was the date it originally opened. And believe it or not, there was actually a steel bridge before this steel bridge. So this is a very historic location and has seen a generation of bridges in its wake. But I'd also note that what we do want to see is what things can be done to improve service short-term as well as midterm, and what is our long-term trajectory. So those are the sort of scope items. My expectation is that as we do this engineering evaluation, we will come back at various points in time in the process, brief you on the conclusions. And also, this will probably point its way to other engineering work that will be necessary before we sort of begin to implement any changes around the steel bridge. So this is the start of a long process. And I think it's an important contract, and one that I do recommend your approval. And certainly be happy to answer any questions, as would Dan or Dan Blocker or other members of the staff here.
All right, thank you. Questions from the board?
Yes. This is an informational question for me to understand the procurement process on the scoring in the procurement section of the resolution. Has a cost estimating and cost controls as a criteria, and I don't see that on some of the others. Is that because this is a personal services contract, or why is that?
Yes, and each contract, depending upon the scope, may have a slightly different set of criteria by which the contractor will be evaluated. In this sense, one of the things that we want out of this particular kind of engineering is experience in cost estimating and controlling project costs. So that is obviously a very important part of this, is to give us good foundational cost estimates about what various scenarios or courses of action may be. And so it was deemed to be up to the higher echelon of criteria.
So they'll be providing cost estimates for future projects?
Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
Thank you.
And cost controls, of course, deals with their own services and their ability to control their own cost.
Okay. So. Thank you.
Good question. Other questions by the board on this one? I think we think it's fairly important. So is there a motion from the board to approve resolution 16-01-08?
I'll make a motion.
Motion.
Second.
Second down there. Any further discussion of this item? All right, then. All those in favor of the motion to approve resolution 16-01-08, please signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye. Those opposed? Abstentions? Hearing none, the motion is approved unanimously. Thank you very much. All right, so that concludes.
Excuse me, Mr. President. Would you take a motion for a break?
Of course. How long? 5 minutes?
Sure.
Okay.
That's what you want. Yep. Thank you.
You bet.